Good morning, members. It's time and we have a quorum. Mr. Ben Chen, the chairman, and Mr. Oh Nok-hin, deputy chairman, are stuck in traffic, so I'm chairing the meeting for the moment. Item one on the agenda, election of the chairman and deputy chairman if necessary. So first of all, may I ask members, do we wish to elect the chairman and deputy chairman again? No? Who are the chairman? Ben Chen and Oh Nok-hin. No need. Okay, then there's no need to elect the chairman and deputy chairman afresh. I will chair the meeting until they arrive. Do you agree that I will continue to chair the meeting until, well, of course, you're well respected. So until Mr. Chen and Mr. Ao or Mr. Ao arrives. Okay. Can we invite the administration to join us, please? Item 2 on the agenda, review of assessment mechanism for hillside escalator lanes and elevator systems proposals. The administration is now joining us. If you wish to speak, please press the button. Or just raise your hand. If you wish to speak, just raise your hand. Maybe the administration could take us through the paper first. Mr. So, good morning. And government officials, you may start your presentation. Thank you. Together with the Transport Department, Highways Department, and the consultant, we would like to report to members the review, the latest progress of the review of the assessment mechanism for hillside escalator links and elevator systems proposals. Now, usually this involves our public walkways and they are major projects. So we have to have regard to the topographical features and the geographical location, and then we have to consider address issues such as land titles or slope risks and so on, especially if it's there are private lobes, then it would be more complicated. And also, on the alignment and the design of such HELs, people have different views, especially for those at the bottom of the hill and those on top, they may have different views. So usually the department needs more time to address the different views. And we want to speed up the HEL proposals. That's why we've engaged a consultant to review the assessment mechanism and improve upon the scoring system so that we could come up with ways to set priorities for different projects. Now, there are two steps to the assessment mechanism as suggested by the consultant. So there will be first a pre-screening to take out the non-feasible projects, and then there will be scoring system to set priorities. There will be technical assessment, and also there will be new criteria to review the needs and possibilities. The detailed scoring system will also consider the social and cost benefits. This is to make sure that the proposals will benefit more people. And then there will be then government resources will be put to good use. Now we have had experience. We made reference to past experience on HLE projects, and then so we have reviewed the weighting of the different scores, and we've improved upon the scoring system in response to public concerns. There are now 114 proposed. There's now preliminary assessment and also preliminary alignment proposals. And then in the first quarter of 2020, we'll be able to identify a batch of projects with better benefits. And then we could review, we will soon complete the review on the scoring system, and there will be at least 20 items for scoring. I will now invite a consultant to take us through the proposed revision to the scoring system, and we welcome views from members. Mr. Ho Kai-ming. Thank you. Well, congratulations, Deputy Chairman, that you're able to get here back successfully. Oh, the Transport Department is going to do a briefing first. Okay, sorry, then Transport Department first. Sorry, I didn't realize that. Now, we would like to report to members the latest progress on the review of the assessment mechanism for HEL proposals. Now, in January 2017, the government announced the policy address to engage a consultancy study to review the assessment mechanism for HEL proposals. The consultancy study started in December 2017. It should be completed within this year. And there are now 114 HEL proposals. There will be preliminary screening, and then there will be initial screening, and then there will be detailed scoring to set priorities. Now, we have consulted the transport panel in December 2018 on the proposal, and then we have also attended a public hearing of the panel in May 2019 to receive views from the public. Now, as we mentioned to the transport panel in May 2019, the following areas won't be covered by the review mechanism, by the assessment mechanism. And that is, if it's just a bridge link, one single road to another, to a single bridge, or if it's really covered by the public works program, or it's within hospital or public housing estates, or it's in the public land, then it's not a private land, and it's not covered. And there are two steps to do the assessment. First is a initial screening, and two, detailed scoring. For initial screening, we will have comprehensive technical assessments on the technical feasibility of the project. Now, if those projects with falling conditions will screen out inadequate land, insurmountable technical difficulties, level of difference is too large, and or there are similar facilities and so on, then for those who do not have these features, then they will be included in the detailed scoring system. And then we will come up with proposals with evident benefits. And then we will consult the district council to make sure that the technical details are right. And then based on the scoring system, we will set priorities and to come up with the first batch of projects. On social benefits, we will consider the number of beneficiaries and target, and whether the proposal could be completed as soon as possible, that is implementation, readiness, and convenience. These are the three factors for scoring. Our cost effectiveness, after we've consulted the district council, we will have regard to the technical details to estimate project cost per user, and then we will come up with the score for comparison among different projects. For the 114 HGL proposals, we are now doing preliminary technical assessment and preliminary alignment proposal. And after we have screened out those projects who don't meet our criteria, then after we've screened out projects that do not at all meet the scope of the HGL, then we will do initial screening and then conduct preliminary scoring of these proposals. In the first quarter of 2020, we will select a batch of HGL proposals of high effectiveness. We will then consult the relevant district councils, and we hope to complete the entire scoring process by 2020 to finalize the first batch of projects. We expect that to be no less than 20 projects. On the financial arrangements, we've had regard to members' suggestions made earlier. We have set up a dedicated fund or a block. We are now studying feasibility of setting up a dedicated fund or block allocations ahead for HGL projects. But usually for HGL projects, those usually they involve a larger scale and with greater level differences. So usually the projects will cost more than under the block allocation arrangement, because a block allocation arrangement is usually to cover projects of a smaller scale. And so, but for each project, cost estimates may be very different. That's why it would be difficult to have a separate block allocation prepared for HGL projects. That's why we believe it's better to go by the established public works procedures to deal with HGL projects. Now we welcome views from members. Thank you, Madam Chu. Two members have indicated the wish to speak, Mr. Ho Kai-ming and then Mr. Michael Oh, and also Mrs. Regina Ip. First, Mr. Ho Kai-ming. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, again, congratulations for arriving at the venue as the Deputy Chairman. Will you have contracted congratulating me for the second time. I have two questions. First, it's about the funding proposal arrangements. As you know, for such a major escalators and lengths, people would want them to be completed as soon as possible. But if we go by what the Transport Department has suggested, that is, we just go by the established public works procedures to deal with these projects, and then if you have to deal with each of the project at the council, at, say at the finance committee, then it, the process will be long drawn. Now, when the government consulted different universities to build student hostels, it's decided to set up a special fund to deal with it. So can we not make reference to a similar arrangement if there's agreement by the legislative council? Of course, we could still consider proposals at LegCo, or if members wish, they could always ask for a particular proposal to be taken out for separate consideration. But then if we have to deal with each proposal separately, say for Lamteen, that may cost $300 million or $400 million, but there could be delay in the process, and so the whole project will be delayed. So would you really reconsider how we can deal with the funding for these projects? I think the contention is not about why you're not building these projects, rather why you're taking so long to do these projects. And then for the, you know, some of these systems, maybe they are on the side of a highway, or they the project may straddle a highway. If that's the case, can you make sure that there are safety measures, make sure things, people cannot throw things from the footbridge above, so that the footbridge could be used safely, and also we could ensure the safety of motorists and road users? Who's to answer the question? Well, Mr. Ho mentioned two issues. For the second issue, I'll ask the Transport Department to answer on funding arrangement. Now, block allocation usually is for smaller projects with smaller costs. But then for HAL proposals, usually there is a need to overcome differences in level, and there are more technical considerations. That's why the construction costs may vary widely. Let's say for some of the projects we are doing now, the most expensive project could be is actually $600 million. And then the cheapest project may be just $10 million. So there's a huge difference in cost. And because each project is different in terms of the nature and the technical complexities, if we go for block allocation, it will be difficult for us to proceed with projects. That's why we propose to go by the established public works procedures in dealing with funding. Sorry. Before the department give a reply, can I just say this? Now, on the funding arrangement, you're right. That it's fine to go with the government proposal, but really, I don't think the project could be as difficult as one for building a student hostel up on the hill at Chinese University, but still there is a fund to cover some 10 different student hostels. So why don't you make reference to the practice of the other bureau? Because we are talking about projects that are not controversial, and there's a strong public needs for these projects. So I just hope that you're able to speed up the process. So please refer to the practice of the other bureau. This is a special measure they've taken. So you have to make sure that members are able to ask questions, but at the same time, you're able to speed up the whole funding process. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Now, the projects that we have received, among these projects, none of them straddles the highways. But your views are noted. We will pay more attention to security, and we will also take this into account in the detailed design. Thank you. Mr. So, any supplement? Yes, Mr. Ho's view has been taken. Next, Mr. Ko. Thank you, Deputy Chairman. Good morning. About these hillside escalator links and elevator system, HEL, we have been talking about this for a long time, but then the progress has been very slow, very unsatisfactory. I believe that this is well received, and the citizens welcome this kind of project. I have some questions first about the scope of the project. In the paper, it mentions that for those HELs that are connected to private development projects or private lands, these will not be considered. I remember previously the director has mentioned that there is a plan about HEL projects that could connect or join the housing projects or private lands, just one project like this. And this is for the convenience of the citizens, also for the people doing business in these areas. So I'd like to ask the government, you just mentioned that this kind of projects are of large scale and of great importance, but how come you don't include those projects that are joining to private lands or private development projects? And second, about financial arrangement, I have some suggestions. When I was talking to the residents, most of them are worried about the time or the duration of the projects. As we all know, we have been talking about these HEL projects for a long time, and it would take a very even longer time to complete it. Let me cite an example. A health project in Lam Tin, it has taken about 8 to 9 years to complete. Well, Chairman, for the financial arrangement, just now I heard that they would do this according to the established procedures of public works. But my suggestion is that to expedite the process, the project, can we perhaps put in multiple projects for consideration? That is, we could submit these projects in a batch. We do not need to consider the projects one by one. Are you willing to consider these arrangements? For instance, each time you could consider 2 to 3 HEL projects. As we all know that members from different parties do not have a lot of contentions about these projects. My third point is about the selection criteria. On the paper, you mentioned that you have received 114 projects or proposals. I'd like to ask the government if these 114 proposals will be considered, and then you hope to be able to select no less than 20 of those projects that would be implemented or for priority implementation. But then there is such great demand. Is it possible for us to add, let's say, 25 or even 30? I think the more the merrier. I think now you set the standard. No less than 20, that's really too few. Can we work harder and try to create a better condition or environment for the residents in a shorter time? If we have 114 proposals right now, but then in the future, if you receive more proposals, how are you going to consider those? Now you have 114 proposals. As you all know, our members have a lot of different views. If you receive 115 or 116 proposals altogether, how are you going to handle them? Thank you, Mr. Cole, for your questions and suggestions. There are three questions. First, about the scope of the HEL projects. For the HEL proposals, that is, hillside escalator links and elevator systems are two different kinds of projects, and they involve different costs, and their respective scope are different. So we use different implementation mode, and there are different scoring system. For hillside escalator links, very often these involve new walkways that. So we believe that for the escalator links that connects the public housing estates, it should be considered by the public housing projects. And for elevator systems, they are basically of larger scale and involves higher cost. So we think that for better use of public funds, the HEL system that connects to private development or public housing should not be considered under the scheme. And in the future, we will review the system and see whether we could use the accessible model to apply to these HEL projects. And for selection criteria, we mentioned that we want to select no less than 20 proposals for priority implementation. Well, if members agree to this revised selection mechanism, we can go on with the second step. That is, we can screen out the infeasible or inappropriate proposals, and then we will consult the various district councils. We hope that we can come up with no less than 20 proposals for priority implementation. Will that be more or less? Well, it depends on our screening result and also the consultation results. We will consult with the district councils and then report to this committee. For the final number of proposals received, of course, we do not know yet. We will consider your views if you have any. Mr. Koh, do you have any follow-up? Yes, I think the director is not really very clear about my point. Actually, in our review, we find that there are a lot of problems. For instance, if it connects to private lands, private development projects, or public housings, we can't do these kind of escalators or elevator systems. But I think we should not exclude those. Second, you mentioned about no less than 20 proposals. I think the government should be more proactive, because you always mentioned that government policies are people-oriented. And our CE often mentions that she cares about the people. So I think you should go back and review. In the present situation, the government should really be more proactive and work really harder. We should use a new mindset to think about how to tackle our existing problems, so that the citizens would be at least happier with the government. Thank you for your view. We understand your concerns and your views. Thank you, Chairman. About the implementation timetable, we agree that we could consider a number of proposals in one go. But that depends on the preparation work. For instance, when we conduct a consultation, is the consultation smooth? And then the alignment and design, whether these multiple projects are sort of common in design and alignment, so that we can consider them in one go. And now we mentioned that we will select 20 for priority implementation. Well, actually, after they have been started, we will then consider the second batch. Well, of course, that depends on our existing funds and cost effectiveness. If there are new proposals coming up, we will group the remaining proposals with the new one, and then we will give them scoring, go through the scoring mechanism in one go. Any other members? Mrs. Yip? Chairman, well, I am really disappointed after hearing the government's briefing. Over 100 proposals and you choose only 20. That's so few. Actually, the people have been waiting for a long time. For instance, in Sha Tin, they really have to walk a long way, especially the elderly citizens. First, the time is too long. It has been dragging for a long time. Second, the proposals or the projects to be selected is too few. If you said that you want to go through the established procedures, I think that will be too time-consuming. I think you should choose the proposals and group them in different batches. You should, the different parties could consider the residents at the same time. I believe that the people would welcome this kind of projects. Well, my view is that they should be considered or go through financial allocation in one go or by batches. At least I think you should select no less than 50 of those proposals, and then you can compile a special list, say 50 proposals, and then fast track the process. You could ask the secretary to talk about the with the LegCo chairman, maybe convene a special committee in the LegCo, and then go through the funding allocation process. How long do you want to wait? Because the people have been waiting for a long time already. I think we should not be so bureaucratic. Thank you, Mrs. Yip, for your suggestion. It's a very good suggestion. We will consider them very carefully. Well, actually, for today, we hope that we can finalize on the assessment mechanism, and then we will consult the district councils and then talk with the local residents. And we really would try to put forward the proposals as soon as possible. Would it be 20 eventually? We would consider. Why do you set it at 20? Is it because of the lack of funding? No, not because of the lack of funding. I think we have to listen to the views of the local citizens regarding the alignments and the project designs. Because for alignment, it would affect the project time or the project duration. So it is our target. 20 is just our target, but we do not have not set a ceiling. Why did you set 20? Is it one for each district? We have 18 districts. They have all the districts have demands. Why do you set it at 20? The transport department, please. Yes, it's because we want to select the proposals, and that's why we now come up with a proposed assessment mechanism. We have to consider cost effectiveness and convenience, etc. If the scoring is high, then the projects will be selected. I'd like to supplement how we would expedite the process. In the present such revised mechanism for assessment, there are enhanced procedures because we find that in the past, there were some scores that should be considered separately. For instance, would environmental impact assessment be conducted? Would the project be too close to the residents? Well, in the past, we have a lot of resistance for these projects, especially residents on the uphill and downhill areas. They have very contrasting views. And now, in the revised mechanism, we want to refine the process and so that we could expedite the project. We would also consider the estimated pedestrian flow. If there are higher pedestrian flow, the scoring will be higher. Well, for these assessment mechanisms, are the recommendations made by the consultant? Yes, these are come up by the consultant. Of course, we have taken into consideration the assessment mechanism of 2009. That is the former mechanism. Well, actually, they are not very complicated. I think you could come up with this kind of recommendations. So we don't really need to engage a consultant to do it. I believe that your department, your officials could do it. Is it because you don't want to bear the responsibility and that's why you always try to engage outsiders, a consultant, to do this kind of review? Well, this is just part of our consultancy report, our consultancy study. Our consultant has to consider or carry out technical assessment for all the 114 proposals. And these will be conducted at a later stage. The consultant has to do a lot of preparation works. Well, at this stage, the consultancy study has already included the technical assessment of the 114 proposals. So this is really a lot of workload for the consultant. And it's different from the accessibility project. But then for the HEL projects, very often it involves land ownership issues, and it might involve enhancement of slope works or enhancement work for slopes. So it is different from the those kind of accessibility projects. So we need to conduct a lot of initial stage preparations. Can we expand the numbers, for instance, much more than 20? That is, we have some concern, and that's why we set it at 20 first. Well, then I have a question. You set it at 20. Is it because the consultant has already conducted some technical assessment, and there are 20 of those proposals that are more feasible? Is that why you set it at 20 and not 30, 40, or 50?
We have to look at the manpower we have. We'd also like to focus the resources to start with the first batch. If we say we should go with 50 in the first go, then we may not have enough staff to deal with that. So that's why we propose to do it by batches. Now, apart from the 20 projects, for the other projects, they actually have a relatively low score, but we still need your agreement on the review mechanism. And once we decide on the review mechanism, then we could work out the score for each project, and then we could pick the 20 projects. You mean for these 20 projects, you're doing 20 projects in one go is because of your staff capacity, right? That's the real the key consideration. And where are these staff from? Which departments? And then there is much consultation to be done. I also said there's going to be a technical assessment as well. So compared to the Universal Accessibility Program, we need a lot more staff to deal with the HEL proposals. Which department is responsible, please? Transport Department and Highways Department. Who's taking the lead? What's the work arrangement? Highways Department and Transport Department, how do you share the work? Well, basically it's us leading because we're still looking at alignments. So it's about transport issues. So that's why I said that there will be a preliminary technical assessment. And when the District Council agrees to the alignment, then we will set up a project. And from that point onwards, the Highways Department will take forward the project. So you still can't tell us. If you have to take on more projects, and what kind of, you know, what level of staff do you need? How much more staff do you need? Or is it the case that you don't really want to do that many projects? Undersecretary? Well, I don't think it's really a question of staffing. Rather, we would like to do detailed consultation with the local communities on the technical issues, the alignments, and so on. And also, there may be environmental considerations, so we need to spend more time on that. Just now, the Transport Department colleagues said that mentioned staffing considerations. It's not that there are staffing constraints, but rather it's a matter of how we could do this properly. And so we estimate it will be more than 20 projects. Of course, we're not just doing 20 projects, but we'll consider a basket of factors to decide how we will take forward the next stage of the proposals. Well, that is still not a satisfactory answer. Well, district councillors are not able to give you any technical suggestions. You have consultants. You know exactly what the technical challenges are, so you don't need to spend too much time on that. So the district council just needs a quick discussion, and then you could hand it over. Now you said initially 20 projects. Now you're saying not less than 20 projects. So I don't know what you are thinking about. Can you give us a program, please, so we know how many stages you have? Yes, please provide a time frame or timetable. You know, for these 20 projects. What is the program? I will submit a paper after the meeting. Mrs. Yip, anything else? No, then Mr. Onok Hin. I have two questions. First one, can I ask government officials to consider about consistency of policies? I always say this. Now, whether it's Hillside Escalator or Universal Accessibility Program, doesn't matter how different in nature they are, but there are similar practices. I understand that with any policy, it should allow as much flexibility as possible, or it should that you should be allowed more power to implement the policies. I see that in many cases, two policies could be proceeded with together, but then there are inconsistencies. The first is the land resumption ordinance. For this project, you could do land resumption ordinance, but it's not the case for the UAP. So when we consider whether a location is feasible, technically feasible for construction of the escalator, this is the major difference. Another question is about connecting the footbridge to private properties. Now, in paragraph 3 of the paper, it says that if the alignment is the project is to be linked entirely just to private land, then we cannot proceed with the project. Well, as you know, that with this year's UAP, you are starting to take into consideration tenants subsidy tenants purchase scheme and other projects that are the properties that are to be demolished. So why don't you do the same with this HEL proposals? Then there will be a better chance for us to build more such HEL projects, because you are now stuck with a private ownership, and so you're not able to proceed with many projects. So that means we can't even get through the stage of feasibility study. Now, there is there was a criterion originally that is there will be priority given to projects that link to public transport systems. Now, if you do that, actually, you could be talking about plenty of private properties, because you're talking about projects, properties on top of MTR stations, for instance. So if you don't allow private ownership to be consideration, how are you going to proceed with any of these projects and achieve your objectives? Now, I'll explain the difference between UAP and also the HEL, and then I'll answer the other questions as well.
For the connection point, we would like to ask our colleague from the Transport Department to supplement. For the UAP, it is specified that we will not resume private land, but for HEL projects, it involves walkways. So usually, we will use the road works use and compensation ordinance to deal with this. So we have different mechanisms for these two kinds of projects. For the UAP, as Mr. Al mentioned, it involves kind of public housing or also public housing for sales. We understand that even though it is private premises, they are also people renting those units. So that's why UAP covers these places as well.
And we have already mentioned that we will take the opportunity to see whether it is possible to provide a hillside escalator system. The connection arrangements will be done by the Transport Department. Thank you, Chair. In the vicinity, the public transport facilities, including the malls at MTR stations and bus termini, actually, in the land lease, it is stated that there should be a 24-hour access to be provided, and many malls are doing that. If you ask me whether later on there may not be this requirement in new leases, we are going to discuss with the land lease owners. Well, but of course, we don't want to take over the ownership of the malls in order to do this. Mr. Au, Undersecretary, if you say you are going to give detailed consideration to the experience of the UAP, well, there is limited revision to the program documents. But then if I have heard you correctly, you are saying that the new the private lease owners will have to sign an agreement. And I'm talking about the latest provision for UAP. That is, if you want to provide a lift, you will have to tell the private land owner that they will have to give the opportunity for the government to do maintenance, and that private owner has to enter into an agreement with the government. Actually, you can apply the same policy measures to hillside escalators with regard to semi or full private ownership. If you do not align the policies, then members and district personalities, when we consider whether we should submit a plan, well, we may have doubts. So I will really like you to give this very careful consideration. The second point is, very often in leases, there may be the stating of a 24-hour access. But I can give you an example, and that is for the benefit of the Assistant Commissioner, Mr. Michael Law. I'm just giving you an example. SIL, Wang Shuk Hang Station. We have said that there should be a point where we can connect to Cheng Pak Sha Secondary School. But then the station has been built. However, there is no connection, no bridge whatsoever. It was hoped that after completion, the private developer will actually provide the bridge connection. Well, it may be because of selfishness and they are not connecting to Shamwan. And we are talking about a very short flyover. So the space is there, but nothing is built. And we are thinking whether the administration can actually take it over and do it sometimes. Well, if we want to fill the gaps in terms of accessibility, which is not provided by private owners, I think you should consider that. Can you answer that question? Thank you for those two remarks by Mr. Ao. We will consider the first one carefully, the first one, and two, when we extend UAP to TPS and PRH, we will gather the experience to see whether we can also build hillside escalators. As to that particular case you mentioned, the TD will communicate with the private developer and the MTRC. Right, next is my turn. First, the administration's reply with regard to the fund, we are of the view that it is important to have a fund to build uphill hillside escalator links. As you know, if you want to take a project to the PWSC, you know how long it takes and how difficult it is. So we propose to you that you should have a subhead to deal with this. As Mr. Jonathan Ho was saying, in other bureaus, if you're talking about student hostels, well, you have $15 billion per university to approve such projects. If these public projects are not controversial and there is a dire need on the part of the public, I can't see why we can't have this subhead. So, Undersecretary, I hope you will give this very serious consideration. If you are telling this subcommittee today that you don't intend to do that, well, then, well, you can see what happened. There were 20 elevator systems. They were 10 years ago. And now, today, how many projects have the government completed? Those that were completed were taken up as part of other larger projects, and those people already did it. But if you are talking about standalone hillside escalator links, there are just a few that are being undertaken, and I think the rest will just have to stay put. Now you have this bottleneck in funding. If you can resolve it, I'm sure you can resolve a whole batch of problems. So, Undersecretary, will you give more in-depth consideration to this uphill escalator system fund? Thank you, Mr. Ben Chan, for your remark and question. As we were saying, why don't we consider having a head or a fund? This is because each project is different, and I can give you certain figures. In terms of construction, it takes about 3.5 years on average. Why does it take so long? It is because we have to do a lot of district consultation. And very often, it takes a long time. As in the principal project, we know that there are people living uphill or downhill. And these people may have very different views about the alignment or whether it should be built, and it really takes a long time. And Chairman, you mentioned certain projects, but then I have two pieces of good news for you. Before December, two projects would be completed and commissioned, including Chang Hang Estate in Qingyi and also on Waterloo Road Hill. We expect them to be commissioned within the year, and we of course want to complete and commission as many projects for the use of the public as possible.
Yes, you mentioned that it will take 3 years from the commencement of projects to the completion, to the commissioning of the project. But then we can see that all the processes are getting longer and longer. As you can see in the Finance Committee of the Legislative Council, very often now, recently, we can only give approval, funding approval to only one project. So I don't know how long you'll have to wait for these projects to receive funding. Well, if you mentioned that the different projects have different complexity and design and scope, of course, it's true. But to speed up the funding approval process, it has no relations to the complexity or the nature of the projects. So you just have to consider them in one batch and then also It doesn't involve technical difficulties. So they are two different things. You should not group them together. Of course, the projects are complex. It might be difficult. It might be of large scope. But then it doesn't mean that it cannot receive funding approvals sooner or quicker. Okay. On the other hand, about the assessment mechanism, of course, I understand that you would consider social benefits and also cost effectiveness. But in the scoring scheme, I find that those connecting the escalator links connecting public transport, there are only 3 points would be given. But then for visual impact, 10 scores would be accorded. So that means the government, the public transport policy of the government is to encourage people to take public transport. If the escalator can link to public transport, and it would receive only 3 marks in the scoring system. And if it links to the market, for instance, people living in the uphill areas, they would really need the escalator links to reach the market. But then for this kind of projects or proposals, the scoring would be accorded only 3 points. So I really like to ask the basis. What's the basis of your consideration for this scoring system? Well, for a system, if the pedestrian flow is very high, of course, it will have higher marks. But then for some areas, there may not be high pedestrian flow, but then there is a real need to connect the people to public transport system or connecting them to the markets. This is what the residents need every day, even to connect to the hospital. But then the scores would only be very low. Well, say for instance, if it connects to hospital, you should give it 20 marks at least. Why is it that you set the scoring system like this? I really don't understand. Well, I like to ask Mr. Lo to supplement on this point. Yes. Whether the HEL is close to the public facilities, I think this would be reflected by the pedestrian flow, because we expect that if it is connected to public facilities or public transport, the pedestrian flow would be very high. So it would have 4 points. And for whether there are a lot of elderly people using it and whether it is connected to the hospital, there will be, under this category, 20 points will be accorded. Okay, for 40 marks, that means total score of 40, that means the pedestrian flow has been taken into consideration. But then for other areas, that for instance, in the rural areas, there might not be a lot of residents. The pedestrian flow may not be very high. But then those people really need the escalator links to help them access to the public transport. Yes, I understand that, but I think we really have to consider pedestrian flow. That is the major consideration, one of the major considerations. That is, if the facility is not used by a lot of people, the society might question us why we have to do it and whether it is we are putting public funds into good use. Okay, I have 2 more questions. For the scoring system, you consider pedestrian flow and also whether it is close to hospital, etc. For pedestrian flow, it is an absolute number or a relative number? If it is absolute number, that means it has to reach a certain number. For instance, 4,000 per hour, then this is an absolute number. Or is it a relative number? And the second question is, now you have technical assessment, you have consultation, initial design, etc. All these kind of processes are in place. I hope that you could supplement after the meeting. That is, what is the division of labors in these processes? For instance, for technical assessment, would it give it to an outside consultant? For consultation, that will be conducted by your own department, or would you commission an outside consultancy group to do it? Well, if you separate these processes, then we could assess where the bottleneck might be. As Mrs. Yip questioned, why do you set the cap at 20 proposals? if there are proposals going or reaching your department, we would like to know how do you divide among yourselves. Then we can assess whether you are lacking manpower or where the bottleneck is. Then we could help you expedite the process and perhaps help you overcome the bottleneck problem. I hope that you could submit this kind of supplementary information to us after the meeting. That is your workflow, division of labor, etc. Yes, okay, we will provide that paper afterwards. Mr. Lo, do you have a supplement? Yes, Chairman, you mentioned about pedestrian flow, whether it is an absolute number or a relative number. Well, my answer is that it is relative. That is, if there are less pedestrians, then the score would be lower. There is no absolute number that is, for instance, a minimum number of pedestrians. And also, we just now talked about technical assessment. A consultancy company will conduct that. Well, after the district councils approve the projects, then we will, as the roads, the highways department will conduct other assessment and also come up with a detailed design and also apply for funding. Yes, this is the part that we'd like to know more in detail. For instance, for highways department, when you're handling this kind of projects, how are you going to divide among your staff to handle these projects? Are they all conducted within in-house, or all the works conducted in-house, or are you going to engage outside consultancy? As you know, the government departments, the way they conduct their work is different from those consultancy outside. So I hope that you would provide us with this kind of information, including your work process and also division of labor among your department. Okay, thank you. Mr. Jie? I'd like to have a follow-up question. Mr. Tony Jie. Mr. Tony J. Weijun. Oh, Mr. Paul Zhe, sorry, Mr. Paul Zhe. Yes, Mr. Paul Zhe. About pedestrian flow, are we calculating the absolute number of pedestrians using that facility, or do we consider the pedestrian flow? Very often we receive complaint stating that if the facility is there, then the people would use it. So the pedestrian flow would be the result of the commissioning of the facility. So how are you going to estimate the pedestrian flow? Second point, in designing this kind of project, well, you have to remember that Hong Kong is an open city. For our footbridges, very often it's very convenient. But then we might be worried that in the coming days, we have to consider security issues. Would you consider the different design? For instance, will you take into consideration the security element? For instance, how are you going to make the facilities convenient on the one hand, but also secure and safe on the other? For instance, we should avoid people throwing things from the footbridge to the roads or causing nuisance to the people using the facilities. In the past, we might not need to consider these factors, but now I think we have to. Thank you, Mr. Zhe, for your two questions. First, about the estimation of pedestrian flow, I'd like to ask colleagues from Transport Department to reply. And for the design, I'd like to ask the Highways Department to reply. Thank you. Mr. Lo, please. For estimated pedestrian flow, we would use a kind of transportation model. For instance, how much journey time would be saved, whether the transportation cost would be reduced, whether it is convenient and comfortable to use that route. And that is how we calculate the pedestrian flow. We would also conduct survey. We would ask people their selection of transport or routing. That is how we consider the estimated pedestrian flow, how many people would use the HEL. Next, Mr. Ng from Highways Department. Richard Ng, please. Yes. Right now, we have not received the finalized proposals yet or the projects yet. But in the design stage, we will consult local residents. Yes, when we are at that stage, we would consider the security issues. For instance, the bench or the handrails would be made higher, and the railing would be made higher. And we will also consider whether there are railroads nearby, or should it be covered or not. We would consider all these points at the detailed design stage, and we will consult with relevant stakeholders. And there could be adjustment in the design in order to take these into consideration. Okay, your answer is yes. Well, this is something new to our society, but this is a major issue. In the past, we could make it very convenient, very transparent, but then nowadays it could be the target for destruction, or it might be a source of danger for the pedestrians and the road users. Well, I believe perhaps this is still early. You may not have the chance to discuss this issue in depth yet. But I hope that in the future, you would take this into consideration. Pay more attention to security of road users and pedestrians. Yes, thank you. Your view is noted. We will consider that in due course. Next, Mr. Oh Chong Sing. Wilson Orr, please. Yes, I'd like to repeat my point. I hope to achieve that there is policy consistency. First, I asked about the private properties. I hope that the officials will go back to reconsider this point, because we are talking about universal accessibility program, UAP, that gives the people more convenience. And the second point, about funding approval for multiple projects. If you ask me, I think the most ideal thing is to set up a kind of dedicated fund for the HEL projects. That is a very important measure to expedite the process. Next, I would really like to dig deeper on this question. I heard the officials said that in the initial stage or preparation stage, for instance, technical assessment and consultation, they need to take more time. And this time they have engaged a consultant to conduct a review. I'd like to ask the consultants whether you have considered how you could speed up the process in consultation and also technical assessment. If you have, what is the result? If you have not, why not? And also, I would like to know further about this. For instance, if we decided to implement a project, then the TD would do the initial preparation, and then the Highways Department will conduct the consultation. Do you have a service pledge for these processes? Because very often, I come up with a very practical issue in the in the districts. For instance, in Lam Tin, there is a Guangtin station.
There should be barrier-free access to the MTR station to convenience the shops and also baby prams. But then the file has been opened. However, it was said that they would prepare diagrams, and I don't know whether it's the TD or the HYD that would prepare those programs, and then they would consult people. Okay, members were very forthcoming in providing you with views, and then you would go back and ask the consultants to do feasibility studies. We are now talking about a month or two, but this takes a year or so. I'd like to ask you, what are the target performance pledges for each segment of your work? And if yes, how long that is? If not, why not? And the Undersecretary said that you would like to boost efficiency, but then very often when you go to the districts to do consultation, you would meet up with a lot of problems. Say the members of the public may have views, and then the district councils may have views. But as far as I know, there are views whenever you conduct consultation. Undersecretary, my question for you is, have you ever considered to ask your staff to do more with these views at the advanced stage of work? Very often, if you put emphasis on a project, you would contact members of district councils and you would sound out district organizations to understand what they want, and then you would go back to the district council. Did you do that? You are telling me that at the advanced stage, there may be hiccups by way of consultation. I'd like to ask you how you can smooth out such different hurdles so you can boost efficiency. Thank you, Mr. Wisenor, for your three questions about arrangements with consultants and also their workflow. I will defer to the consultant and the Highways Department. Mr. Oh asked whether we can have policy consistency with regard to private ownership and also the UAP. Well, just in the policy address, we already said that the UAP would be extended to TPS, and we will see whether the Hillside Escalator can be fitted in with such estates. I'd like to emphasize that each project is different in its degree of complexity. It would be more ideal if we can bundle a few projects together. As for hurdles erected during the advanced stage work, actually, our staff work very hard to do consultation, especially before a project is actually formed. We would talk to different people, so we can factor that in our design, and then we can come up with a specific design, hopefully to get support from the district council. We'll continue to step up this part of our work, and we'll continue to do that. But I must say that this kind of sounding out will not take the place of proper and formal consultation. I hope there is no misunderstanding. The consultants can talk about their work process, and the Highways Department can make a simple supplement. Sorry, before you do that, I'd like to say this to the Undersecretary. Frankly, I'm very disappointed with your reply. I'm sorry to say that. Well, I'm not saying that you should not be doing this kind of consultation, but then you give me the feeling that whatever you have decided, you stick to it. Actually, we need these hillside escalators to facilitate the public. I hope you will try to remove the different barriers. You don't have to answer me here, but you should go back and see how you can further compress your timetable. I understand you have to consult different stakeholders, whatever you do, but I'm talking about compressing the timetable, and then maybe your staff can work even harder. I was giving you an example, and then that feasibility study alone took a year or so, and you were really very much criticized by residents. Consultant, we have learned from previous experience. That's why in this consultancy, when we did technical assessment of hillside escalator links, we have already considered the different problems of launching the project. For example, the alignment, or whether we should have an escalator or an elevator, and the estimated people flow. This is something new that we have never done before. The space needed, the impact on the environment, and hillside escalators' impact on people living nearby. Now, in order to benefit as many residents as possible, as soon as possible, and also to provide convenience access, and we have to consider whether we need to resume land and also the impact on people living nearby. All that is included in the study so that our proposal can satisfy the needs of the public and so that the project can be launched early. The study will help us select some cost-effective proposals in the first quarter of 2020, then we'll take them to the district councils, and it is expected that we can complete the entire point scoring system within 2020, and we can have 9 projects set out. I'd not like to take up other members' time, but if you will agree, and with the agreement of other members, I'd like you to give us a timetable for the different steps of the entire process and what difficulties you may meet up with and how you can overcome them. So I'm really talking about efficiency, and no one has really answered my question. And that is, you look at different segments and look into them and see what you can done. It's all right. Give us an information paper after the meeting so that we can have a discussion next time. Mr. Lowe, can I please add? Looking at experience, say, for example, some members of the public were worried about the impact on their sightline and that the escalator may be too near residential dwellings. So the alignment is usually drawn up in such a way that it should not have an impact on people living nearby. That is what we strive to do. And residents won't want us to build any escalator tower. And perhaps we might build an escalator along the slope instead of having an elevator tower. So we will learn from the experience of previous consultations so we can do a better job the next time. Right now, I have 2 motions to be moved without notice. Now we have a quorum, so I will now process the 2 motions first. The first one from Mr. Ong Nok Hin. It will be shown on the screen, or it will be distributed to members. Well, if there is no projection on the screen, then Mr. Ong, can you read it out? I would ask that the assessment and implementation system for hillside escalator links and elevator systems to take reference from the UAP. You would have to factor in feasibility as well, and also there should be a kind of initial assessment. Right. Those who are in support, hands up. Those who oppose, no one. Unanimous. Second one is from me. I'll read it out. We would ask the administration to set up a fund for providing escalators and elevators for hillsides, that it should be regarded as a separate and standalone subhead. Anyone in support? Those who oppose? No one. Okay, unanimous support. Thank you very much. Now I have a question. We talked about private ownership. You said it was one of your factors for consideration. But sometimes, in the lease, there would be a statement saying that there should be the provision of 24-hour pedestrian access. If the elevators or hillsides link up with these 24-hour public access, and if you have an elevator which is going to be for public use, then can these facilities be regarded as part of the system? Of course, it may involve land resumption, and under your assessment, you will resume land and then you will see whether the slope is conducive to the building of an escalator. Well, I saw this situation. You wanted to resume part of the slope, but the place you set your eyes on would mean that the estate would be affected. And then you did your checking, and you may say that before resumption by government, the slope would have to be stabilized, and the entire estate had to come up with the money to stabilize the slope to hand it over to the government. So the government will resume it. If they do not stabilize it, the government will not resume it, and that means that they cannot build the elevator. When you want to resume a slope, can you not just resume it as it is instead of asking people to come up with the funding to stabilize it first? So it seems you are giving the short shrift to the public. I think this is one of the issues you have to tackle. There are two questions. One about the provision of 24-hour public access in private lease and also the assessment system. I will ask the TD to supplement that. And as for difficulties in the construction phase, the Highways Department can answer. Please. Mr. Law. When we consider a new proposal, we'll consider connections around it, including existing elevators, and whether we can build a 24-hour access. But then, if private ownership is involved, we cannot compel the owner to open the access round the clock. We have to talk to them. There was a motion on the assessment system. I'd like to respond to that. As I said, at this present stage, we are already doing technical assessment to see whether there are initial insurmountable problems. And we believe that our proposed mechanism already includes such consideration. Thank you. Highways Department. Mr. Ng. Thank you, Chair. Talking about slopes, when we promoted uphill escalators, we did encounter such problems. But the thing was not that we assessed the slope and then we asked people to maintain it. We looked at the slope that we had to make use of, and then we found that relevant government departments already issued a maintenance order. So the residents had to comply with the maintenance order first before we would consider using part of the slope to build the hillside escalator. So there is no question of we or asking residents to do something first, but actually there was this maintenance order in place. Thank you. And also in your assessment, it is said that you would look at whether there is a similar facility within 300 meters. Well, you can consider that it may be a level road and 300 meters is not a long distance, but sometimes it is on a sloppy kind of ground and there is a gradient. When people have to walk up 300 meters, it's not the same thing. Let me talk about Kwai Ching, Shek Lei. There are such accesses, and it's easy for you to see such accesses with a gradient or uneven ground conditions for 300 meters. Would that be too arbitrary? Thank you, Chair. Actually, 300 meters is a distance that people don't mind usually. And if it is longer than 300 meters, they might consider taking public transportation. If within 300 meters there are slopes, then we will want to see whether we will provide the escalator. No, I'm talking about a road with a gradient. Okay, downhill you have a facility, and then here the linear distance may be 300 meters, but then it is sloppy and it can be steep. Now, what can people do?
We would also consider the gradient and the level difference. If the slope is larger than 1 to 8, then we will consider whether there should be an escalator or elevator. If it is less than 1 to 8, then we think that this is an acceptable gradient and people won't mind walking through it. Well, I think, Mr. Low, you have misunderstood my point. I'm saying that if the gradient is 1 to 8, Well, that is a point that you consider whether an escalator or elevator is needed. If the gradient is 1 to 12 or 1 to 7, that is something more than 1 to 8, then you would consider. But what I'm saying is that you have another criterion, that is, if there are similar facilities within 300 meters, then you would not consider installing an escalator or elevator. But if the escalator, that is, if there is such escalator within 300 meters, the gradient is very steep. Someone living in a downhill area, if the person has to walk up to use the escalator within the 300 meter, even though it is within 300 meter, he has to walk a very steep slope to use the escalator. So according to your present criterion, you would not consider installing another escalator there. Well, we would consider the existing facilities and also the connection points. If it is within 300 meters, for instance, if there is another escalator within the 300 meters, but that is leading to another area, not to the point that we want to connect to, then in that case, we would consider installing another escalator. Okay, that is, yes, if it's connecting to the same place, we would not consider making another escalator. Okay, understood. Well, I think members do not have other questions. Yes, Deputy Undersecretary, Chairman, perhaps we would like to ask the subcommittee to accept our proposal for the revised assessment mechanism. Yes, could you repeat, please? I hope that the subcommittee could accept our proposals on the revised assessment mechanism so that we could start our next stage of work. That is, we would work towards having the first batch of no less than 20 projects, and then we will conduct consultation in the district councils. Yes, members have already raised views about the assessment mechanism. They do not have any objection. They just put in some suggestions and also some questions. I think members all agree to your revised assessment mechanism. I think you could go and start your second stage of work. Thank you, Chairman. I hope that you will provide us with information paper as soon as possible. As members have already put in the request of receiving further information paper from you, especially on the screening mechanisms, second on cost effectiveness, third on how you can boost efficiency, and fourth how perhaps you could expedite the process. If there are no other questions, meeting, we will arrange a site visit. But of course, that would depend on the conditions later on. Meeting adjourned. Thank you.